Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at LoveIsrael.org. That's one word, LoveIsrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
Many times people are confused about the Word of God. They read a piece of Scripture and they simply do not understand that. Now, let me say that there is a reason for that. See, when we look at God's Word, we need illumination. We need the Spirit of God to work in our life to teach us. And therefore, there's a very important principle that we learn from the Gospel of John concerning understanding the Word of God. So let me begin today by asking you a question. And that question is, do you realize why God has created you? That is to say, why He has put you upon this planet? The answer is found all the way back in the book of Genesis. Now, we know that there's a connection between the book of Genesis and the Gospel of John. And in the Gospel of John, we're going to find that Messiah Yeshua, that He speaks to us concerning this principle from Genesis. For in the book of Genesis, it speaks about humanity in a general sense. And what we learn is this, that we were created in the image of God. And that fact says a great deal about understanding the revelation of God. Many people will say, well, what's the connection? Well, what does it mean that we were created in the image of God? That word makes it very clear that we're called to reflect God. That is not to say that we look like God, but we're supposed to behave by God, like God. We're supposed to be doing the same things that He were to do if He became a man. And that's exactly the message of the Gospel of John. So when I desire to reflect His character, to do the things that He would do, what is the benefit of that? Well, that's where we left off last week in our study of John's Gospel in chapter 7. So with that said, open up your Bible and please look there. The Gospel of John and chapter 7. Look with me to verse 17. Now in verse 17, there's a very important principle. And if you don't learn that principle, and if you don't apply it to your life, you are not going to be someone that understands the Word of God. You're going to be someone who is spiritually frustrated, someone who simply cannot hear from God, so that you'll be able to respond and walk with Him, serve Him, and know the joy of the Lord. So what does that verse say? Well, Yeshua is speaking. In fact, most of what we're going to be talking about over the next several weeks is Yeshua's discussion with leaders. And here we find in the Gospel of John chapter 7, it is the Feast of Tabernacles. Yeshua is there in Jerusalem, and to our surprise, because He went up secretly, He knew that there were individuals who wanted to kill Him. But in the middle of that festival, what did He begin to do? Well, He began to teach in a most public manner. And the people were amazed at His teaching. They were not only amazed, but they knew that there was something unique. And here we have that principle. Look at verse 17. See, many of the people were confused about what His purpose was, what He was revealing. And notice what He says in verse 17. If any man desires His will. Now, many of the English Bibles don't translate this correctly. They leave out a few words. But if we literally translate, it says here, if any man or anyone desires His will to do. So we need to stop for a second and ask ourselves, does that describe myself? Is that what I want to do? Do I desire to do His will? And if so, what's the outcome of it? It says, and you shall know concerning the teaching. Now, there's the proof. When I desire to do something, His will, when that becomes the passion and the objective of my life, therefore, the result of that is this. I'm going to understand the teaching of the Word of God. Let's look at it again. If anyone desires His will to do, he shall know concerning the teaching, whether from God it is, or if I speak of my own self. Now, we're going to learn another principle that comes out of this same verse, and that is this. When someone is speaking, and the context here is attempting to reveal truth from God. See, there's many people who are spiritual counselors, who teach the Word of God, and we're going to learn a very important truth concerning each of those. How to discern whether, in fact, they are revealing truth. So, once again, he says at the end, whether I from myself am speaking, or what, or from one's own self. And he says in verse 17 or 18 at the end, he says, for the one who speaks of his own self, his glory he seeks. Now here's the key. If someone is seeking his own glory, what's the problem with that? Well, he's not desiring to do the will of God. And therefore, his revelation is not going to be teaching from heaven. That is, it's not going to be revelation from God, but it's only going to be his own words. And that's why it's so important, and we make an emphasis, to only stick with the Scripture. Not to give all of these principles that man comes up with and tries to support them with the Word of God, the exact opposite. We understand that principles come from the Word of God. We're not trying to justify our wisdom, what we think about life, how we think people should live, what we think they should do with their resources, but we want the Word of God to be the key. And that's exactly what Messiah is saying. So one who speaks of his own, that is, his own wisdom, from what he believes, this one is seeking his own glory. Now move on to verse 18. But the one who's seeking the glory of the one who sent him. Now, here Messiah is speaking about himself, but it's a principle for all of us. See, when he speaks about the one who sent him, that phrase appears over and over in the Gospel of John. The one who sent me, that one is God. And that expression, the one who sent me, is an expression of authority. What is Messiah trying to reveal about himself? He's revealing that he, everything that he said, everything that he did, his reason for being in this world is to submit to the authority of God. And those two things go together. When I understand that I am called to submit to his authority, when I do that, what's going to be the outcome? I'm going to be a vessel of God that manifests his glory. And when I do that, I am fulfilling the purposes for which I was created. And that is going to be a great source when I'm doing that. It is going to lead to greater revelation. The Spirit of God is going to work in a mightier way to bring about the illumination of his word so that I can understand it, I can grow, mature, and be more valuable as a kingdom vessel. That's what Messiah is trying to say here. So his teaching is based upon the authority of God, and that's going to be very important as we move through chapter 7 and especially into chapter 8. Once again, verse 18. But the one who is seeking glory, it says, of the one who sent him, this one is true, and not only that, it says, and unrighteousness in him there is not. Now, I translated that very literally because of the quality of this passage being emphatic. What do I mean by that? What he wants to emphasize is the fact that there is no unrighteousness in him. And we see a connection. We see a connection between truth, one who walks and lives in the truth, And the outcome of that is that there's going to be no unrighteousness in him. That is, he is not going to violate the truth of God. Whenever someone violates the truth of God, the outcome of that is there's going to be unrighteousness in his life. And what is that going to bring about? Well, when there's unrighteousness in our life, it is an invitation to the enemy to begin to work, to get a foothold in our existence, and begin to accomplish his purposes rather than the purposes of God. And the key that Satan is looking for is when someone is walking and living in a prideful manner. That is, when he is trying to glorify himself. That is, like I said, an invitation to the enemy. Move on to verse 19. Now, Messiah, in speaking to this group, notice how he keeps going back, and we'll see this not only this chapter, but the next one, how he keeps utilizing the Torah Moshe, that is, the law of Moses. You see, these individuals, and don't miss out here, who he's speaking to primarily are the leadership of Israel. He's in Jerusalem, he's at the temple, and therefore the leaders, they have come to hear him. And remember, one of the things they're wanting to do is to seize him for the purpose of putting him to death. So once again, verse 19, it says here, "Has not Moses given to you the law? But none of you do the law." Now, remember who we're talking about. Not just simply speaking about Jewish people, but he's speaking about a term that oftentimes I translate the Judeans. The Judeans, as I said, these were the leaders. And what was unique about them? Well, they were following what was called the Masoret Hazkanim, which is the traditions of the elders. So here he's pointing out, you know, they're following what they believe. They're following not the revelation of God, but the tradition that has been handed down from one spiritual leader to another. And when I say spiritual leader, I'm talking about one who was professed to be, not one who was under the anointing of God. Why do I say that? Because there's a connection, biblically speaking, between the anointing of God and the submissiveness to the Word of God. And we know something. We know that Yeshua, for example, in the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 15, he makes a very important statement. There he speaks about the traditions of the elders, and he says this. He speaks to the leaders and say, "Why do you forsake the commandments of God for the traditions of man?" Now, this is of great importance. What it teaches us is this. When we follow the traditions of man, we forsake the commandments of God. And that's why he says here in verse 19, he says, "Now, has not Moses given to you the law? But none of you do the law." Verse 19, the second half, he says, "So why are you seeking to kill me?" Now, the point he's making is this. They are accusing him of wrong teaching. They are accusing him of someone who is disobedient. And he says, wait a second. Even if I were, and he's not. See, they didn't perceive his teaching as being in line with the Word of God, with the law of Moses, because they were so far removed from truth. And when we're removed from truth, what's going to be the outcome? Well, that turning away from God's Word, not applying the commandments of God to our life, it is going to give us a faulty perception. We're not going to see things from God's vantage point. So when one comes about doing perfectly the will of God, the commandments of God, teaching spiritual truth from heaven, these people didn't recognize it, because they had been deceived by their own traditions. And they, as we know, going back to the first part of chapter 7, remember when Yeshua didn't want to go to Judea because of those who were killing him? So he's confronting them. He has depended upon his heavenly Father. He has gone up out of obedience to Jerusalem in order to keep the festival, the Feast of Sukkot, the Feast of Tabernacles. And now he's teaching in the midst of the temple. They are listening to him. In one sense, they are amazed that he knows all of their teachings. And now they're accusing him, and he's saying, wait a second. You know, why are you so upset with me? For you think that this is not from God, but what you're doing is not from God. But he brings about this truth that they are indeed wanting to kill him. And what happens? Well, look, if you would, to verse 19 and now verse 20. And the crowd, and this is probably the crowd of leaders, the crowd answered and said to him, you have a demon. For who is seeking to kill you? Now, the point that's so important to make is they're denying it. But we know earlier on, and the people knew, and we'll get to this in a few minutes, that indeed that they had this plan to put him to death, to seize him, and to bring about the death penalty upon him. That is their objective. And this is not based upon any type of Torah truth, that is revelation from the laws of God, but simply because they don't like his teaching. Why? And it's because it is convicting. It manifests sin in their life. And he's going to speak about that in the next few minutes. See, when we rightly come in contact with the truth of God, whether we embrace it or not, but when the truth of God is being proclaimed, it is going to have an aspect. And what is that aspect? Of conviction. It is going to bring about a recognition that we are in sin. And many people don't like that. So they're simply turn away, and many occasions, what they do is this. They look for someone who is just going to justify them with their words, saying that they're okay, they're right, that God wants you to be happy. Well, he does. But the only place for you to be happy is in the midst of obedience. But see, their false teaching is this, that you can be happy in your will, pursuing your dreams, instead of submitting to the authority of God, listening to his will, desiring his will, wanting to bring glory to his name. That's where joy is found, when those things are objective, not when we're pursuing the vanity of our own desires. So Messiah says here in verse 20, first of all, the crowd answers and says to him, you have a demon. Who is seeking to kill you? So they're denying it, but we know the truth. And Yeshua answered and said unto them, one work I have done, and all of you are amazed. Now, what is he referring to? Well, the context is this. We have to go all the way back to chapter 5. And he's there in Jerusalem again, once more, for a festival. And he heals a man who had been lame for 38 years. He did so on the Sabbath day for the purpose of revelation, that is, revealing something about his identity, that this healing took place on Shabbat. And they were amazed, but they were also angry, because they did not like what he was sharing about his authority, what he was revealing, because it came in conflict with what they were saying. So notice, it was because of that, and he's bringing it to their remembrance, that they wanted to kill him. But now he's going to prove and justify what he did and when he did it on the Sabbath day as a proper deed in regard to what? The law of Moses. One of the things that's so important for us to perceive is this, that everything that Yeshua did was in line with the scripture. In fact, when we look through the scripture in the Gospels, we find that it says Yeshua did this in order that the scripture might be fulfilled. He did another thing in order that the scripture might be fulfilled. So over and over in the Gospels, we find that Yeshua's life was to manifest scriptural truth. And that's a great example for us. But what I want to share with you now is found in verse 22, where it says, "On account of this, Moses gave to you circumcision." But then he says, but really, it was not Moses, but the patriarchs. Now, why is that so important? Because many people wrongly tie circumcision to the law of God. You ought not do that. Because circumcision, although it is one of the 613 commandments found in the law of Moses, it did not originate with Moses, meaning this. Moses did not receive that commandment originally. He received it. He wrote it down in the law of Moses, but it predates Moses. We know that. Here again. What is the key to understanding the Gospel of John? The book of Genesis. And it's in the book of Genesis in chapter 17. In regard to not the law of Moses, the law of Moses doesn't come into effect until the book of Exodus. But it is in regard to another covenant, a covenant with Abraham. So it's with Abraham and Yitzchak and Yaakov, the patriarchs, that circumcision came into being. And circumcision is so important because it is related to the covenant of Abraham. And what is the purpose of Abrahamic covenant? Well, many of the rabbis get this right. It is a kingdom covenant. And circumcision, and we've learned this many, many times, circumcision is about the death of the flesh. What's the basis of Abraham's covenant? What causes the kingdom to come about in one's life? Faith. And so it's when we're exercising and living in faith that it's going to bring about the death of the flesh, that we might live in obedience to God. So what we find here is that there's a connection spiritually between circumcision and spiritual health. Why do I say that? Well, remember the biblical truth. We know that circumcision is the death of the flesh, the yetzer hara in Hebrew, that carnal nature, that sinful desire that is within our flesh. And so faith brings about the death of that. That is spiritual healing. That is spiritual health, when we're not living and walking in the flesh, but we're living under the authority of the Spirit of God. And what's the best way to do that? Live under the authority of Scripture. There's an inherent relationship between scriptural truth and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and don't miss that. There is that connection between walking under the authority of Scripture and living under the anointing. So Messiah says here, verse 22, "On account of this, Moses gave to you circumcision," but it was not really Moses that circumcision is from, but it is the patriarchs. "And on the Sabbath, you circumcise a male." So we all know, and this is true today under Jewish law, it's always been, we are commanded in the Scripture to circumcise on the eighth day. So if a person is born, a male, and 8 days later, on that eighth day, is a Shabbat, he is still circumcised. So one circumcises in order that what? That man, male, might be healed. Circumcision in Judaism is seen as a spiritual act of healing. It causes that little boy, this 8-day-year-old child, to what? To come into a new relationship, a covenant relationship with God. See, we don't say in Hebrew circumcision. We always say brit milah. Circumcision is milah in Hebrew. Brit milah is the covenant of circumcision. And under Jewish law, there's a great difference between just simply removing the foreskin, circumcision, and the covenant of circumcision. So notice what we read here. He says, "On the Sabbath day, you will circumcise a male. So if you circumcise, if a man receives circumcision on the Sabbath day, in order that the law of Moses won't be broken," he says, "to me, why are you mad? That a whole man," and this goes back to the miracle that he did in John chapter 5, when he restored that individual back to walk, back to what? the ability to walk. And walking is an important biblical truth. In the scripture, walking has to do with lifestyle. So when there's a healing, when a lame man is able to walk, what it's saying is God has moved in his life, this healing has come about in order that that person might live in obedience, that he might have a lifestyle that is pleasing to God. So Yeshua says here in the middle of verse 23, "Why are you mad that a whole man I have healed on the Sabbath day?" Now, the Sabbath day is a day of restoration. The Sabbath day is related to the kingdom. So Messiah comes, and specifically, and so many of his miracles happen on what day? Happen on the Sabbath day. Why? Well, we've talked about this. In Judaism, on the Sabbath day, after the reading of the Torah, we pray to God to heal the sick. God heals. He can heal anytime in any way. But there's a connection between healing and the Sabbath day, this day of restoration. So Messiah, likewise, to show his identity, his divinity as the only begotten Son of God, he healed frequently on the Sabbath day. So he says, "Why are you mad at me? You bring about restoration even on the Sabbath day through circumcision." Remember circumcision, spiritual healing. You do it. Why can't I heal an entire man on the Sabbath day? And therefore he says, and here's a problem, he says, "Do not judge by appearance." And this word means earthly appearance. But he says, "But you shall judge a righteous judgment." And pay attention to that phrase, righteous judgment. Why? Because the term righteous is inherently related to the kingdom. Why do I say that? Well, look sometime at the book of Matthew chapter 6 when Yeshua says, "Seek ye first the kingdom," and it's what? It's righteousness. So there's a connection between the kingdom and righteousness. And what he's trying to tell them is this, that you need to judge things according to a kingdom truth, not based upon the wisdom of this world, which is a false wisdom, which is a fallen wisdom. He says, judge things from a kingdom perspective. And let me close with this. It's only when we accept Yeshua, when he's living in our life, are we going to be able to have that kingdom perspective. Well, I'm out of time. Until next week, may God richly bless you.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of LoveIsrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, LoveIsrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.